Thanks for joining us. You're watching Eye on Africa on France 24. I'm Julia Kim. These are the headlines on the continent. Ethiopia's government says it will end the 10-day conflict in Tigray in a very short period of time. As thousands flee to neighbouring Sudan, there are fears the country is teetering on the brink of a civil war. France confirms it's killed a jihadist commander in Mali. The death of Ba'ag Moussa on Tuesday has been hailed as a major success in the fight against terrorism. And in Senegal, people have paid tribute online to the hundreds of migrants who've died trying to reach Europe. Undocumented migration from West Africa has surged in recent weeks amid a growing economic crisis brought on by the pandemic. But first, Ethiopia's government has promised a swift end to the 10-day conflict that's rocked the rebel Tigray region. Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed, winner of last year's Nobel Peace Prize, ordered a military strike there last week, sparking fears of a civil war. A communications blackout has made verifying accounts on the ground difficult, but reports are emerging of gruesome massacres of civilians committed by both sides, according to witnesses. The fighting and airstrikes have sparked an exodus with thousands fleeing to neighbouring Sudan. Maria Girth Niculescu is in Addis Ababa for us.
Amnesty International said it used satellite imagery as well as geolocalization of photos and videos to confirm the location and date of the massacre. The report confirmed that several civilians who were not involved in the conflict between TPLF forces and governmental forces were killed in Maikadra with machetes and knives. It's still very difficult to verify any information about this massacre because phone and internet connections are still shut down in Tigray, and it's therefore impossible to know exactly how many people were killed, as well as who are the perpetrators. According to eyewitnesses who spoke to Amnesty International, pro-TPLF forces killed mostly Amhara civilians after a TPLF defeat in the zone. UN High Commissioner for Human Rights Michelle Bachelet is now calling for an independent investigation on the massacre, and she's also saying that these killings could amount to war crimes. Analysts are saying that the Maikadra massacre could increase Amhara involvement in the conflict as well as determination to remove TPLF leaders. On Friday, Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed issued arrest warrants against several TPLF leaders, and this includes a Debretsion Gebremichael, who is the president of the Tigray region and who was replaced on Friday. The African Union also had to replace its security chief after Abiy Ahmed accused him of being disloyal. Six journalists were also arrested since the beginning of the conflict, and others were prevented from reporting near the Tigray border.
Now, French troops in northeast Mali have killed a key figure of the jihadist movement in the Sahel. France's army minister described the death of Ba'ag Moussa on Tuesday as a major success in the fight against terrorism. A former Malian army colonel, he was close to the leader of Mali's most prominent jihadist group. Ba'ag Moussa is thought to be responsible for several attacks against Malian and international forces. France 24's Wassim Nasir has more.
It happened on the 10th, around 6 p.m. He was intercepted by helicopters, French helicopters, and then by special operations forces on the ground. So it wasn't a raid. They tried to stop his car, then he didn't stop, so they went on the ground, and there was a shootout. And this is how he was neutralized. He is a very well-known figure in the region. He's not just nobody. Okay, he joined jihad after 2012, but before that, he's a very known Tuareg figure. He participated in the guerrilla in northern Mali. He has classical curses, if I may say so, because he was active in the rebellion in northern Mali. Then he was among the Tuareg who joined Libya, who were in the ranks of the Libyan army under Muammar al-Gaddafi, and who joined back northern Mali in 2012. And in between, he was two times in the Malian army. In 2006, after the Algiers agreements, he was even given the grade of colonel in the Malian army. That's before he defected at the end of his career, if you may say it this way, to Iyad Ghali. He was very close from Iyad Ghali, the head of Jama'at Nasr Islam Muslimin, which is the Al-Qaeda operative in northern Mali. He joined him in 2012, and he kept with him till his last days. But something very important. He was really a military commander, a military operative up to the end of 2018. And from the end of 2018, as far as I know, up to the day of his death, he was more of an instructor, a dogmatic instructor, a military instructor for middle-ranking commanders in the ranks of Al-Qaeda.
Well, moving on to South Africa, where President Cyril Ramaphosa's drive to root out graft in the country has claimed another high-profile name. Ace Magashule, the Secretary General of the ruling ANC, is facing multiple charges of fraud and corruption. He's accused of awarding millions of dollars worth of contracts to his friends back when he was a regional premier. MC Ferreira has more from Cape Town.
When Ace Magashule stood up in court today, what we effectively saw in the dock in Mangaung is one faction of the deeply divided ruling African National Congress. It's the faction opposed to President Cyril Ramaphosa's anti-corruption drive. And in the streets of the city, we saw a stark reflection of these divisions. Magashule's supporters were out in force proclaiming his innocence, but there were many detractors saying instead he deserves to go to prison for what he's done. He's the third in command of the ANC. He was indicted today on 21 charges of fraud and corruption, and he's due back in court only in February. So only time will tell how risky this is for the president as he tries to retain control of the party and whether the state will manage to secure a conviction. It's notoriously difficult in cases involving complex corrupt contracts such as these, but the state's hopes were buoyed somewhat, as we heard today, by Magashule's private secretary having agreed to enter into a plea bargain to testify.
Now, in the last 2 weeks, hundreds of young Senegalese migrants died at sea trying to reach Europe in fishing boats. Undocumented migration from West Africa to the Spanish islands is on the rise amid a growing economic crisis brought on by the pandemic. But as Eliman Nandawa reports, the government has done little to stop them.
A cloak of grief and sadness hangs over the entire Cisse family. 18-year-old Dauda, the family's only son, died at sea at the beginning of November while trying to reach Spain in a wooden dugout. His mother is heartbroken. In recent weeks, undocumented migration has caused more than 140 deaths in Senegal, according to the International Organization for Migration. The local press claims that figure is closer to 500. At the fishing wharf in Bour, the point of departure for many migrants, this grim statistic doesn't deter would-be migrants any less. This fisherman blames the depletion of fish stocks. For the International Organization for Migration, in addition to the economic crisis, social pressure is one of the factors that continues to drive young people to leave.
La sensibilisation doit se faire à plusieurs niveaux, pas seulement au niveau du potentiel migrant, mais il faut faire la sensibilisation au niveau des parents des migrants parce qu'il ressort que souvent les parents sont partie de l'équation qui fait partir le migrant à la migration irrégulière.
Many Senegalese have criticized the government's silence following these tragedies. No major initiatives have been taken to prevent the departure of these young people to Europe. No day of national mourning has yet been decreed either, but deeply moved by the tragedy, an online vigil has been organized by internet users to pay tribute to the victims.
And we end in Mbato, a small town in the center of Ivory Coast, which has been in the national spotlight this week. Protests against the president, Alassane Ouattara's third term, sparked violence between two communities there. Images of alleged massacres flooded social media earlier this week. But are they real? Our reporters went to find out.
The wounds of this week's violence are still open in Mbato. The pro-opposition Ani group fought with the Malinke, a northern ethnicity seen as pro-Ouattara. The town hospital is still housing many of the injured. In the treatment room, the northerners blame the Ani.
On est parti pour protéger nos biens qui sont au marché là-bas. Bon, c'est dans ça maintenant, quand ça a commencé, ça allait un peu devant et puis ça a commencé à tirer et puis bon, moi j'ai reçu une balle. J'ai reçu une balle sur mon œil.
In this Anyi neighborhood, young people have created a self-defense committee. They say that it was the Malinke that attacked first. Prior to this incident, the two groups got on well.
On a même pas besoin avec eux. On se côtoie de jour en jour. La preuve en est qu'ils ont pris nos soeurs et nos nièces. Ils ont fait des enfants. On n'a pas besoin avec eux. Et c'est nos amis.
Both sides deny being the ones to trigger the clashes, which were only settled once the army had been deployed. The violence in Mbato drew the national spotlight, especially online. Rumours of dozens killed and hundreds injured flooded social media, with fake gendarmerie reports only adding to the confusion. One video even showed a decapitation. After verification, it became clear that it was shot elsewhere, in Daokro. At the hospital, the director insisted that only 6 people had died, with casualties on both sides, not the 40-plus deaths alleged online.
Il dit que notre mort, notre toute petite mort, pouvait contenir un tel nombre de corps. Vraiment, c'est plus invention, c'est des fake news. Là, en réalité, ce n'était pas ça. Donc, ce qui fait qu'on a eu beaucoup de coups d'appel des personnes qui nous connaissent, qui s'inquiétaient pour nous, et nous les avons rassurés.
While there were serious acts of violence, the spreading of fake news on social media greatly exaggerated its scale. This was a deliberate political strategy, according to this disinformation specialist.
L'objectif est bien clair. En faisant, on sème la panique, on sème le désordre, on sème l'inquiétude. Et vous avez vu l'impact de ces fausses informations au sein de la population en termes de cohésion sociale.
Recently, rumors and fake news have often provided the spark that ignites communal conflict in Ivory Coast. According to the government, at least 85 people have died since August in clashes linked to the presidential election.
Well, that's it from us. Charlie James is up next with the latest world news headlines. Stay tuned.